Okay, we are live once again. Welcome everybody to this week's version of Carolina Retirement Planners Happy Half Hour, broadcasting to you here from, well, I'm in 7th and Market in Wilmington, and with me here is my daughter and partner, Sam Shikavich. Say hi, Sam.
Hi, Sam.
And
I see what you did there.
As many of you know, but if this is your first time, for the last 140 some weeks, we'll find out exactly how many in a minute. We have, since COVID occurred, we started having a little get together with folks on Thursday at 4:30. Grab your favorite drink and we'll have some fun and learn some stuff. And today our subject, what's our subject today? You're doing today's presentation, Sam. What is our subject?
Life insurance in retirement, why you might need it.
A lot of people wonder, do I need that now? And some people do, some people don't. We'll find out more as we go along. But also, as usual, we are accompanied by the lovely Amy, our Director of Client Fun.
Hello, how is everybody? How are you doing today?
Well, great. We are doing great. Good. Hopefully everyone here is too. Amy, how many weeks have we done this now?
Oh, let's see here. This is week number 147.
147.
Wow.
So when we get to 156, so we are about 9 weeks short of 3 years of who come into folks and
that's say,
that's a lot of you, that's been pretty good. And we also like to kind of recognize or celebrate what day it is. What day is today?
Ooh, okay, so today is Dragon Boat Festival Day. Mm. So in, you know, celebration of that, I asked everybody what their Chinese zodiac sign was, and we had some good answers. But before I did, I looked up yours, both of yours, and you guys are spot on. When I read it, I was like, this is spot on, both of you. I mean, it's kind of funny. So yeah, so I'll let you guys talk about what you think yours is, and then I'll tell you what it says. So what do you think yours says?
Well, I know that I'm the rabbit and I know what it says because you already told me. So I would be lying if I made guesses.
Yes. I mean, it is. It's like that smart and elegant and stylish, yet, you know, very, very like quick and, you know, the whole little, the rabbit persona. And then David, you're the monkey. Did you know that?
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah. So you're also like that, you know, smart, just thing like monkeys, what they do, but you're also kind of like a little jokester and a prankster and, you know, just kind
probably
of like,
just highlighting my incredible sense of humor and wit. That's probably
it's kind of funny. Absolutely. I'm an ox. So,
and that makes a lot of sense too.
Yeah. I'm an ox and a Taurus. So I'm just like both ways coming blasted at me. So yeah, I always wanted to be a dog when I was little. You know, do you guys remember going to Chinese restaurants when you, like, before they were all takeout and you would actually sit down and they were restaurants,
had a little with all the different years. Yep.
Yeah. I was like, why can't I be a dog? Why?
I was actually in San Francisco during Chinese New Year and walked the parade route as they were setting up, and it was the year of the dog, and they had all these really cool, adorable, awesome floats and, you know, all these things that, to celebrate the year of the dog.
I always wanted to be the dog.
I really
am. Anyway, you know, let's go here.
Well, okay. Monkey, huh? Hmm.
Do you, here on the side note, do you know what, just for like reference, the two most, I guess, Chinese zodiac signs that were the most popular were the rooster and the dragon. So I don't know if that means anything, but yeah, those were the two most popular that people, like birth years that came in.
Okay.
I don't know a lot about them either.
Oh, you wanna kind of plunge in, Sam, and begin?
Yeah, absolutely.
And while you're getting that together, I'll say hello to Debbie and Jean, who are with us. Teresa is here as usual.
Hi, Mom.
We also have Fernando here with us, and Dan and Barb. They are checking in. But I can't read where because something's covering it. It'll be
They're in the mountains.
Well, there it is, from the mountains. They're in the mountains. Robert is here saying hi and having a Malbec. Our own Kristen is here. Get away from me here. And in fact, the whole team up there is there. We got everybody in one room now. And Miranda is here as well. And Jay and Carter, as usual, are here. So just good to say hi to everybody.
Awesome. Well, hey, everybody, welcome. And so you're with me today. And so we're going to talk about why you might want life insurance in retirement. It's something that we talk about a lot with clients. You know, there was a certain reason you bought it before, and that reason may have passed. And so what might be the point of it or the value in it today for you? Now, first, let's talk about income replacement. So this is really why you bought it when you were younger, to protect against a drop in income. So, you know, you wanted to make sure you could at least cover the mortgage or cover kids' educational expenses and, cover a certain amount of risk if one of y'all were to die early. But in retirement, there is also a risk of having your income drop. And if you're married, you are most certainly going to have an income drop. So say you have a couple and each of you has Social Security. One of you is bringing in, you know, say $30,000 a year, and the other is bringing in, you know, about $25,000 a year. Now, if one of you passes, it doesn't matter which one of you passes, the survivor will lose the lower of the two Social Securities. So you'd go from having, you know, $55,000 a year in guaranteed income to $30,000. So there is a drop there. And the other income drop could be from a pension. So say you had another, you know, $30,000 a year coming in from a pension. Now, whenever you are about to retire and decide on your pension, you get all of these decisions. You could take it 100% survivor. So all of the rest remainder of that would go to your spouse if you passed. They could get 75% of it. They could get 50% of it, or they could get none of it. And so a great thing for life insurance is if you have chosen to take your pension at less than 100% survivorship, then you could buy a policy to replace this missing income. So if this couple took the pension 0% survivorship and the pension holder died, they would lose, you know, another $55,000 of income. They would have had $85,000 a year and go down, the survivor would go down to $30,000. So this is one of the, you know, the traditional easy places to get life insurance.
And there's a tangential lesson here as well. And that is, if you haven't started Social Security yet, one really important decision you make is how and when you start it. And usually one person will, usually the one with the highest Social Security may want to wait to 70 to get the most. And the other person might start earlier, but that way when one dies, the other one maximizes how much they make. We've got calculators that figure that. And all same way with the pension, real important decision
Yeah.
How do I take it? And I'll tell you, everybody sleeps better if you take it with 100% survivor, but that, those are two key decisions, and this kind of highlights it.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Now, moving forward, we like to think of life insurance kind of like phones. You know, here back in the day, you know, you had some kind of phone. Maybe you spun it around to dial, but basically all it did was call people, and it was probably connected to a cord. Until, you know, they had the cordless phones. That was a big deal. But pretty much you would use a phone just to call people. And similarly with life insurance, you basically, you know, bought the life insurance, and if you died, you got the money, you know, and it was, you know, pretty straightforward. But nowadays you have this, this smartphone, and your phone, you can text people, you can check your email, you can check the weather, you can browse social media, you can watch movies, and in a pinch, you can even call people. So just like cell phones have evolved to do all this myriad of to solve these myriad of things in your life, the same goes with life insurance. So one of the really cool ways that we will use a lot is long-term care protection. So life insurance companies saw this long-term care need, and they saw that traditional long-term care policies were getting more and more expensive, didn't make as much sense for people to buy anymore. They had priced them, you know, priced it wrong to begin with. And they thought, you know, can we step in and fill this gap? So now you can buy a permanent life insurance policy. And, you know, say you buy enough and you have a $300,000 death benefit. If you qualify for long-term care, need to go into long-term care, or you can't do two of the six acts of daily living and need help at home, they will actually, give you like a fourth of that every year for 4 years. And so they'll actually pay out that death benefit you've paid for while you're still living. So that's a really cool way to protect against long-term care needs while retaining control of those funds.
Are you saying I no longer have to die to enjoy the benefits of my life insurance?
I am saying that. I am. They call it a death benefit, but you no longer have to die to enjoy it.
That's fancy.
Yes. You know, another way is to do a wealth transfer. Now there are, you know, if you want to give money to your heirs or to anybody and you hate taxes, this is a really great method to do this. So if you have a certain amount of money that you would like to give to your kids, then you can put that into a life insurance policy and immediately get, you know, 2 to 3 times what you put in there in death benefit. And then it goes tax-free to your children. So you kind of lock in this guaranteed tax-free growth there, you know. And in fact, I made my picture a little bit big here, but, you know, say you have an IRA, you know, for a number of years, you can take money out of that IRA, and instead of converting it to a Roth, you could put it into funding, you know, a life policy. And then you would capture that tax-free growth that would be passed on to your kids and beneficiaries. And this actually works really well in tandem with a long-term care protection. So you can have a pot of money that you don't plan to spend, you really want to go to your kids, but you're also kind of worried about long-term care. So you have it there if you need it, but if not, then it can continue to go, you know, to your family.
And You know, with there's taxes are likely to go up, and money in an IRA is a sitting duck. And if you can put into something like this, one thing that has survived tax changes very well is the tax advantages of life insurance. And absolutely, even when they change the rules, they usually grandfather in existing policy. So if you really want to be sure they get it without taxes, that can be, and it's even better if your kids are earning a lot of money, because if you leave them the IRA, they're going to pay, it's going to be paid at their highest tax rate. So
yeah, the best money to leave kids is tax-free.
It's often said, some of the life insurance gurus we've worked with say people buy life insurance for one of two reasons. Either you really have someone you love even more than yourself, or you really hate taxes, you know. If you're out there and you're a tax hater, this is one reason you may want to consider it.
Absolutely. And that, you know, it's just another way to diversify your assets, diversify your tax status, and, you know, a great way to do wealth transfer to the next generation. And then we have tax-free income. So this is another reason that you might want to look at purchasing life insurance. Now, we don't talk about this as much because it normally takes like 10 to 15 years for the policies to really get cooking. But if you're, you know, between 55 or 60, or, you know, your early 60s, this can make a lot of sense for you. In a normal policy, like what we just saw, you're going to buy as much death benefit as possible for as little cash as possible. You're going to put as little in there as you can to guarantee, you know, the most. But inversely, in these policies, you might try to put in as much cash as possible, as much money as possible, and get as little death benefit as possible. Now, you might be asking, you know, why would you do that?
Why don't I want to pay as much as I can for as little life insurance as I can get?
Exactly. Well, inside of this policy, that cash is growing every year. So the cash continues to grow and compound in there. I know that some of y'all may have some like old whole life policies that they're sitting there with a bunch of cash in them. Well, these are designed specifically to accumulate cash inside of them. Now, when you get to a certain point and that cash has really been chugging along for a while, you can take that cash out as in the form of a loan, as a policy loan. And, you know, you could do that and provide yourself income for years in retirement. And Dad, do you pay taxes on a loan?
No. You got a car loan or a mortgage, you don't pay tax on that money they give you.
Exactly.
Loans are not taxed.
Exactly. So you're able to get that money out, that cash out of the policy as income, tax-free to you.
But don't I still have to pay that loan back?
Absolutely. And when you die, this death benefit pays it back. And if you have anything left in there, the rest of that death benefit will go to your kids.
Now, why is it I want to get as little death benefit as possible?
Well, because what you're paying for, what you're trying to pay for, is the cash accumulation. Now, you'll still get a death benefit there, but you're trying to optimize this cash growth inside of the policy rather than optimizing as much death benefit as you can.
Because I think they charge you for that death benefit every year. So by buying as little as possible, you get more, the loan grows even faster because it's not supporting that.
Exactly. So if you had more death benefit, then it would be more expensive, just the cost of insurance. So you're in here trying to put in as much cash and pay for as little insurance as you can for that cash. And like I said, they have policies these days that are structured specifically for this purpose. And what's cool is, you know, we're talking about this for retirement, for retirees, but the earlier that you start this, the more chance this cash has to grow and compound over the years. I've seen people purchase this for like infant children or infant grandchildren, where they buy it on their life and they'll pay for it until they're, you know, 15 or 18, and then continue to let that grow. And then they'll have a really nice tax-free income or tax-free bucket to access during retirement. And if you have a kid who, you know, they're putting stuff into their 401k, this is another way that they can divert some of that money and create another, you know, tax bucket and diversification for your retirement income. Or, you know, if you start early, you get to 40 and you want to, you know, pay for their kid's college or put a down payment on a house, you know, you can access this in a myriad of ways. So these are pretty cool. And those are my main reasons. Now, I know a lot of people will come and they'll have an old policy. They don't know, you know, exactly what they have. They've just had it for a number of years. Sometimes when you look at it, it has a lot of cash in it. Sometimes you look at it and they're showing that it's going to run out at a certain point. But if you have an old policy, it's worth taking a look at and doing a review of that to say, you know, do I have cash? Can I put this in something else and, you know, do something better? Or, you know, is this policy going to benefit me in my retirement planning, in my income planning, in my estate planning? So it's always good that if you have an old policy, to have that reviewed periodically to make sure that it's still serving you and your circumstances. And with that, that's what I have to say about life insurance today.
That was pretty darn good. That was pretty. I'm proud. You did a great job.
I think it's good.
Well, it's, you know, it's kind of difficult to make the intricacies of life insurance like very enthralling. I think that Dad, you do it better, but. I'm never going to get better at making life insurance.
I got to run for my money. You know, if your jokes were just a little bit better, you'd be just as good as me.
No,
you know?
I thought it was great.
I had more of that year in the year of the monkey, if I was year of the monkey.
No. This actually gives us good time because I believe we have a giveaway to talk about before the wine. Is that correct?
We have a giveaway right here. And this is a you know, sometimes you could think of, when you think about retirement, you're kind of building it. And this one is evaluating your blueprint for life. And it talks about having a policy review. One of the things is, if you have an old policy, usually when people come and see us, we often have them get some current illustrations and see, is their current policy healthy? And is it, you know, so, if you'd like a copy of this, Amy will tell you how to get it, but we will send it to you here on paper, actual paper. Remember, paper, you don't want to read this on your cell phone. We'll get it to you where you can, you know, read it. And if you don't need it, you can then line the birdcage with it, you know?
So. Oh my gosh, I love it. You know what? I have to say, I'm just going to chime in on this paper thing. I love paper. I love reading a book. I love actual paper. And last night I was talking with my daughter in regards to magazines and how I had sent my grandson National Geographic, not the kid, but the real one, subscription, and it had run out. And I was like, oh, I should renew it. She's like, no, we have Apple News. And I was like, yeah, but he can't hold it. She's like, she just gave me this funny look. Oh, I should turn my video. she just gave me this funny look, like, I was like, oh yeah, he's eight. They do the screens. They don't really do the paper, but we do, we're still in the paper generation. We want things. We want to be able to touch it and read it. Yeah. And so, yeah.
Usually I joke, we'll print it on dead trees and deliver it to your home by a uniform employee of the US government. But that joke may be getting old, you know?
No, I think it's good. But if anybody would like a copy, all they have to do is send an email to Mary@carolinarp.com and she will send it out for them.
Or call the office and say, hey, send me one of those things, you know?
That too. Yeah, absolutely.
Yep. And I believe that it is time for our weekly wine drawing. And if you have not been here before, each week we give away two bottles of wine delivered directly to your door from Fermental Bottle Shop. So Fermental is newly located in the Cargo District in downtown Wilmington, recently featured as one of the top bottle shops or beer bars, I can't remember what, in Garden and Gun magazine.
One of the top six in the South.
Yeah, yeah. And they're a great place to visit, go in for, you know, a glass of wine or a pint or take stuff home with you. But if you win this wine, you don't have to leave your living room because we will ship it right to your door. And to enter each week, we'll have a little thing on Facebook, an event on Facebook saying what we're talking about. And if you click that I'm going to that event, then we will we'll get you in here. And if you're on our email listserv, then we'll send out an email every week letting you know what we're talking about. And if you send back letting us know what your Chinese zodiac sign is, or just say, enter me into the wine drawing, we'll get you in here. All right.
General. So,
winner of two bottles of wine is, drum roll please, Barbara and Fernando M.
Oh, Barbara and Fernando.
And I think I haven't looked at the chat, but I think that he was here.
He's, I think, here. So. Yeah. It, you know, it was storming. There was no golf today. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Congratulations.
Awesome. Yeah, congratulations. Woo. And to everybody who did not win today, please continue to enter. We love to give away wine. We'll keep doing it. And next week could be your week. And we do. They carry them very well.
What are we
well.
Talking about next week, Amy?
Oh, next week is an interesting one. It's the story of proactive Sally and oblivious Jerry. Yeah, that's a new one.
The week after that, the week of July 4th, I think we're going to have, we've done this twice now every year. I'm going to be broadcasting from the Uari River. I'll be doing this. We'll have questions and answers as I sit in my kayak fishing in the Uari River. So you want to be here for that and get your questions in. What are you wondering about? Get us lots of good questions, because we'll be answering them. We'll be answering them from the river in my kayak.
Yeah, we always have more questions than can be answered. So that'll be July 6th, but please feel free to send them in now, because
I think sometime, I don't know, we may not have put it, but sometime in July, I'm going to do after that kind of a mid-year update where how things are doing. And we're going to kind of have some fun with it. So
that'll be a good one. Yeah.
We want to watch for that. So.
Definitely. Well, excellent.
Yeah.
Well, thank you everyone for joining us today.
You did great. And,
well, I better every time, right?
Yes. No, I love it. Yeah. You're great.
All right. Well, thanks y'all. And thank you everybody. And we will see you next week.
We'll see you next week.
Yeah. Cheers.
Cheers. Bye-bye.